Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about property, plant, and equipment, PP&E, and specifically about what costs we can capitalize. In other words, what can we put into our asset accounts instead of into our expense accounts? Now, most of this is pretty straightforward. It's whatever we spend getting the assets ready for us to use. The only really challenging piece is what do we do with interest expense? Because most of the time, we have to just expense our interest that has accrued. But FASB's carved out one exception. If you have a self-made asset, that whether it's made by you or for you, but specifically to your requirements, then you can capitalize interest during a specific capitalization period and up to a max of either the avoidable interest or the total interest. The max is the smaller of those two. I know that's a confusing way to say that, but you max out at whichever of those is smaller. Now, we've talked about this all under US GAAP, but there's a few differences under IFRS, and I want to take a minute, or I should say a segment, to talk about capitalization under IFRS. So let's take a look at some of the differences. First, unlike US GAAP, under IFRS, companies can include exchange rate differences from foreign borrowings, discounts or premiums that are amortized, lease charges when they're determining their avoidable interest. So we can include a lot of additional factors in making our calculations. Can, don't have to, but you have these other possibilities. And if it's better for your bottom line or allows you to capitalize more typically, then you'll factor these other adjustments in. In addition, capitalization, and this is not a typo, they really do spell it with an S because it's an English spelling or British spelling. Basically the same general rules for the capitalization period. Number one, we have to start spending money on the asset. Number two, we've actually started construction, same as US GAAP. And at the end, this last one, the asset is not yet substantially ready to be used. We talked about that too. That's also a US GAAP requirement. The only difference is this third bullet under IFRS, your borrowing costs have to also start to accrue. So if I start construction in January and I don't take out a construction loan until March, then I, even if I've started paying for it and construction started for 3 months, I can't start capitalizing interest until we get to that construction loan or debt that I take out in March. Now the good news is for a lot of companies, if I don't have a specific construction loan, I've got debt accruing interest all the time. So I'm okay with that particular requirement. The other major difference is in the way we calculate our avoidable interest. They call them borrowing costs, but it's the same idea. It's deciding how much of our interest we can capitalize. And they have two methods, like I said. The first is you have a construction loan. It doesn't have to be a specific construction loan, meaning it has all the requirements of a general construction loan. It can just be a note or a loan that you take out for the construction project. And the difference there is a construction loan is a specific type of loan. In this case, we're saying any kind of debt you take out for the construction with the intent to use all the proceeds for the construction, whether it's the specific finance category of a construction loan or not. If I were to issue a bond for the construction of this project, that would qualify under this directly attributed borrowing costs, same as under US GAAP. If we have a construction loan of whatever kind, then avoidable interest is calculated only using the interest on the construction loan. And I max, instead of with total accrued interest, I max at the interest accrued on the construction loan. That's it. If the funds are borrowed before they're needed, we also have to subtract away any interest revenue that we make by investing those funds from the amount I capitalize. And they leave the finance charge or the interest expense alone. The other option that they provide is if you don't have a construction loan. Again, I can't break it down into financed or unfinanced. It doesn't allow for that. It's either financed or the second option is it's unfinanced. And what I do with this one is I calculate avoidable interest using my weighted average interest rate on all of my outstanding debt. And the maximum that can be capitalized is total interest expense for the whole company. And in this case, I don't have to offset interest revenue because I don't have a construction loan with money that could just be sitting there accruing interest. All of this comes down to the fact that we can't break it down into financed and unfinanced and capitalize both like we can under US GAAP. It's either financed or unfinanced. I can't have both. So for most companies, they're actually better off with unfinanced than they are with financed because my max that I can capitalize is total interest expense, and that allows me to capitalize a little bit more. So if the goal is to capitalize under IFRS, you wouldn't take out a construction loan. Well, to kind of cement this idea and see how it really works, let's take a look at our example. This is the same set of numbers that we used before. So same problem for Roberts, but what if it was under IFRS instead of US GAAP? Well, I would do about the same thing as I had done before. I would calculate a weighted average expenditure, and I'm not going to recalculate it. I assume if you need to, you can go back and look at that number again, but it was $1,031,250. And then I multiply that by the construction interest rate. So in this case, 8%. So $1,031,250 times 8% gives me my avoidable interest, which is $82,500. And that's it. I'm done. A little bit simpler, isn't it, than US GAAP? So now I compare. I take my avoidable interest, which we just calculated, $82,500, and I compare that with the actual interest on the construction loan only. Well, that was a $1 million loan, 8% interest on that loan, so my total interest on the construction loan was $80,000, and now I compare these two. And in this case, I would capitalize, just like I do under US GAAP, the smaller of the two, but this time, that's the actual interest on the construction loan and not the avoidable interest. So if I were to do that journal entry again, I'd debit building for $80,000. I would debit interest expense for $50,000. And just as a reminder, we had $20,000 in interest on a note. We had $30,000 on a general loan, and we have $80,000 on this construction loan. So that's your 80 and your 50. And then we set in the assumptions that we'd paid $100,000. So the rest would be interest payable. And this is record accrued interest. And one thing I want to point out, you'll notice this piece doesn't change. Why? Because the amount we capitalize doesn't affect what we paid and what we owe to the banks at all. It changes what we show on our books, how much is an expense, how much goes into the building account, but it doesn't change the actual payments that we've made. So regardless of what we capitalize, or even if we don't capitalize, it's not going to change the credits in this kind of a journal entry. Now, to finish up our discussion of this IFRS, let's take a look at the other option. Now let's assume they took it out as a general loan, then they decided to use the proceeds to do a building. And since they hadn't actually taken the loan out as a construction loan, now it's the other kind of IFRS capitalization question. It's the capitalization rate method. And again, we want to do the journal entry using this new method. So to do that, again, we're going to start with our weighted average expenditures, which we've already calculated. So $1,031,250. But this time for my interest rate, I need the weighted average interest rate. And I don't know that, so I'm going to have to calculate it. The reason I don't know it is because now this $1 million loan is part of this general debt. It's got to be part of the weighted average interest calculation. So I can't just use the 7.14% that we used under US GAAP. So we're going to set up our table the same way. Debt, principal, interest rate, interest expense. So let's see, we had a note, $200,000 in principal, 10% interest rate, $20,000 in interest expense. We had a general loan, we'll call it loan number one, $500,000, 6% rate, $30,000 in interest expense. And now we have loan two, which we're pretending, just for this example, wasn't taken out for the building, it was just a general loan. $1 million, 8%, $80,000. So if I add these up, 80 plus 30 plus 20 is that same 130 we've been using. 1 million plus 500 plus 200 is 1.7 million. So I can get my weighted average interest rate now as the interest divided by the principal. And again, I'm going to take this out at least four decimal places and get 7.65%. And this number is going over here. And my avoidable interest will be the product. So 1,031,250 times 7.65% is 78,860. Now that I've got avoidable interest, my next step, you remember, is I compare it. Avoidable interest to total interest accrued. So the avoidable is 78,860. The total is this 130 over here. And in this case, I can capitalize my avoidable interest. So let's do our journal entry again. And you remember we said that the credits don't change, so let's put those in. We still paid $100,000 in cash and recorded interest payable for $30,000. That doesn't change. We're going to debit building for the smaller of the two, which was the 78,860, and the balance goes into interest expense as our plug figure, 51,140. Record accrued interest. And that's IFRS. Now in this case, you'd have to decide, am I better off getting a construction loan or am I better off getting no construction loan? In this particular example, I was better off with my construction loan under IFRS. I couldn't capitalize as much as I did under US GAAP, but I still got to capitalize at least $80,000. But if my construction loan interest rates were lower, then I might be better off not having a construction loan so that I can use the higher weighted average interest rate and capitalize a little bit more. I don't have that threshold, a max of the construction loan interest. So it depends on the company, depends on what you're looking for as you decide which way you want to do this calculation. Wow, big concept, big issue here that we're trying to figure out. How do we capitalize interest? It's a big question, because it may play such a big part in our company dynamics. How much goes into our asset account versus how much is expensed is a big deal, especially since earnings per share and net income is such a huge number in financial analysis. If I expense it all now, I take a huge hit this year. If I save it, capitalize it, then I get hit for the next 30 years as I amortize that away with my depreciation expense. So which is better for my company? What would I prefer? How do I do it? Depends, but at least we've got some guidance into what we can capitalize as long as we're comfortable with this method. Now, when we come back, we'll talk about a couple of other things that we have to take into consideration when we're deciding what we can and can't capitalize, and then we get to talk a little bit about what happens when we dispose of assets. So with that preview of coming attractions, I'll see you next time.